Mamas?
Hello, I'm Peter. So nice that you could join, and thank you for the to the host for serving us such nice pizza. I volunteered as a volunteer without any force to present you or to discuss a couple of my experiences with using C++ from Python. So I have no idea what your guys' background is, if you're more developing C++ on an everyday basis or if you're more coming from a Python world and just wanted to see, okay, what can I do in terms of performance if I'm really hitting a border or hitting a limit with Python. So the agenda for the next, let's say, 45 minutes, depending on how quick I am. Typically, I'm very quick, unfortunately. So I just want to shed some light on my person first and then discuss a little bit why the topic is so interesting and why I think it should receive more attention. And then the simple approach that many people choose and the suggestion I would like to make to you. And I'm not really sure if the tools that I will present to you everybody knows or just a portion of you. So bear with me if I'm not diving into the technical details that you would love me to dive into. But in any case, so preface. So who am I? I'm working for a company called Psionics Computer Innovation GmbH, founded in 2000. Oh, we could lower the beamer a little bit, but in any case, so we are a medium-sized company, and we mostly do software or selling a software product for animal facilities. And then we also do a lot of consulting, which brings me to the position I'm actually taking. Wow, maybe we should really try to get the beamer down. So I'm working at the Max Planck Institute for Molecular Cell Biology and Genetics down on Pfotenauer Straße, next Axel. down.
Don't
yeah, it wasn't me. So my plug is as plugged as it can be. It was only for the good. Now that we spent so much time for. Waiting and then pizza now. Okay, let's cross fingers. In any case, this is where I work. That is what this slide is supposed to say. And I'm helping scientists to get their code running on our cluster. I'm having software projects which deal with, or mostly my task is to accelerate them. And then I do some data analysis, machine learning, and you know, all these side things. Yeah. So that's these are basically the proficiencies that we can that we have in stock that we can offer in our team, and yeah, the entire slides are open source. You can find them on GitHub. I prefer doing it this way because then people have the chance. If we leave or part ways tonight, unfortunately, then people can still sign up on GitHub and then drop me an issue. And if they still have a question or something, yeah. Exactly. So why other languages? I mean, when I learned C++ in my community, C++ was the language to code. So it wouldn't actually come or cross my mind at all that it would be a good idea to use C++ from another language, because there's C++. Why would you choose another language? With age and experience, I have to say, I had to see that the productivity curve in other languages, depending on the domain, is just simply much, much more shallow than what C++ has to offer. So basically, one of the reasons why you want to use C++ from another language, in our case Python here, is very simple. You don't want to reinvent the wheel. There are fabulous libraries out there in C++ that offer you high performance and high productivity, but in very general terms, their domain is very limited. So let's say a library for simulation of some kind, or for some kind of deep learning. So why would you actually sit down in Python and just reinvent the wheel and just recode it because you think Python is so great, if something like this already exists in C++? So that was that would be my my top priority reason why I would look into using C++ from Python. The other thing is that teams and communities at large are very diverse these days. I believe we are living or we are working in a world where many communities come with different preferences in terms of languages, and today the situation is that these communities never ever only have one language. right? So I'm a physicist by training. In academia, people are totally crazy. They just try to recode everything they get their hands on because they think their specific language is so nice for the task. But in the real world, what I experience, be it in data analysis or machine learning, many people would like to concentrate on the task at hand. And they want to get rid of all that baggage that sometimes C++ comes with. So this is just my view of the reality, and of course, something that should not be missing in a C++ talk is the argument in favor of performance, right? This is why many people still use, or why I believe C++ is still going so strong next to the renaissance that we've seen in the recent years in terms of the innovation of the APIs of the language. But C++, and that's quite, I hope that everybody can sign that, is for the heavy lifting or the latency bound stuff. So it's really where speed is a high priority. So, right, so the why. Why Python? I don't know, who has used Python before? Can you show? Wow. Okay, half of my talk just went down the drain. No. Just to recap, a couple of features that I would like to highlight because they're interesting to actually discuss later on when we really discuss how to use C++ from Python. So I'm from the Python 3 community. I don't give a rat's ass about Python 2 anymore. Mm. Right? And I don't understand why the community is so split. So I think we should just, you know, get on with our lives and just switch to Python 3. But you don't need to agree. So Python is a dynamic language in a sense that or dynamically typed. That's something everybody knows. We don't need to specify a type when we actually define a variable. And we can actually change this type during the lifetime of the interpreter at any point in time. So the other interesting or important fact is that Python manages memory. I mean, you've probably, if you haven't noticed so far, yes, it does that. What I mean here is that if you have a function and inside that function you create a list and you actually populate it, then the Python interpreter actually keeps track of all the memory allocations in the background for you, and you don't need to care about this as you used to have in C++, for example. So it manages memory, so we have to take care of this, and it's very modular. I'm pretty sure everybody in this room knows the big credo of Python, batteries included. I mean, the standard library that comes with the Python installation is already very powerful. But the ecosystem is even more powerful, and here just an example. The modular import system into namespaces of a current interpreter, that's one of the hallmarks of Python. Yeah? And even more so with the actually quite well-designed package system, be it Conda, Pip, or whatever you have you. So there is a lot to learn here. So here's just probably everybody. I'm guessing everybody knows this library, so I don't need to actually shed any light on this. And of course, then this is the reason for today. Python is popular. So this is from Stack Overflow developer survey. So these are the top 11 languages that they isolated from all their entries. And you can see that this is where we are. And here's Python. And there's the top. So you already see that it's a worthwhile goal, I think, if you have a Python C++ project of your liking. If you make it available to the Python developers, I mean, that's all of a sudden your community just factored out, I don't know, by a factor of 2, 3, or 10, depending on the domain where you actually work. So this is an important observation, I believe. So we can actually help spreading the word about C++ by actually interfacing to Python. So now the question is, how would you actually do that? How would you do an interface? So you have some code, a library in written in C++, I assume, and you want to use that in Python. That is the starting condition that we are in for this talk. So a simple goal would be we write a small library, we call it MyMath, and we want to import it like this into the Python interpreter, be it as a standalone program or inside the wrapper. And we start with it just adding 2 and 3. That's about it. So let's do it the painful way, shall we? So what you see here is the beauty of the C API extension API of the Python interpreter. So let me walk you through it. So if we want to define a module, so again, remember, I assume you have already compiled a shared library, let's say, on your operating system of MyMath that actually contains or that might contain something, and but you want to do it in a Python-esque way so that you can make it available. So this is the way. So you first define a static struct. It has to comply to this struct definition there, this py module def. And then you have to initialize it, you give it a name, you can add some documentation, then you even have to define the size in memory, and then you can actually also hand over some methods. So I think this is only creating the module itself. So far we haven't actually defined any Python function or that any functionality that we can use from Python up until here, basically up until here when we actually initialize the module. We can just do import MyMath, okay? A lot of boilerplate. And we can argue heatedly if we want, if this is beautiful, I think it's horrible. But in any case, it goes on. We're not done yet. We then have to populate the method table. So here's where we actually start having our add function, if you remember. And then we can also add some docstring, and then we have to define some variables, and yeah, and of course a lot of null pointers. And if that wouldn't actually be enough, now we finally can go and have define a function. So just to outline this, out of these seven lines, two of those actually do real work. Okay, so first we have to comply to the C extension API. So we get a Python object, which is the module itself, and then the arguments. Then we actually have to populate our input variables by this lovely definition of types. So F stands for float in this case even. And if that doesn't work, we just return null. And then here we actually do our addition, and then we return the result. Not so great. Doable, of course. This all can be done if you have some quiet 8 hours per day. And yeah, but I believe it feels more like this, if you know who that is. So that's Sisyphus, depicted by Titian in the 15th century. So people already knew back then what pain is, that you always have to do the same thing over and over again. Yeah. And if you still didn't like, if that wasn't enough for you, then let's go a little bit object-oriented. So meaning that we want to work with structs. We didn't even touch inheritance yet. It's just a struct, okay? So then what we have to do, we then have to redefine our struct using the C API. So here I, what did I, this, just some person with the first and the last name and an age. But still every struct that we use here needs to be annotated with this py object head over there. And then it continues, because as soon as you have state in a type, you have to do the memory management on your own, okay? And the Python interpreter does reference counting. And what you see here is that it's a little bit inverted. I will scroll down. But let's start with deallocation. Here you actually see that we actually dereference a memory location, and that we actually have to call free, or an emulated free, if you want to call it like this. And then, and I have to excuse myself that this is a little bit unreadable, but this is partially by design. And then basically, oh, wrong window. Not in my notes. So this is actually the allocation of a new object. So it's lovely, full of letters. That's my first impression. Here we actually have an allocation of a string. Then we have to check something, dereference again. Here's the next string, then do some additional checks. And I think you get the message. It's just overly complicated, and this is C. This is plain C, the good old onion shell, right? First you define something, then you go into a function, then you have to initialize it and potentially allocate something to it, et cetera, et cetera. Cool. Now obviously the question would be, let's switch the window again. Isn't there something better? Anything. Okay, so what we've already seen so far is that besides all the C stuff, okay, you know, we are all grown-ups, we can bear with that if that's part of our job, okay, fine. But there are a couple of other things to note here. Some information was actually, maybe I can also go back, some information was actually encoded in the function name. Where was it? Module function myMath, my methods. Yeah, it starts here. Oh, I think I don't find it. Where was it here? No, I don't have this here. I don't have the example here, sorry. So some portions of this API, you actually have to define the function of your function that you want to bring to Python itself. You have to define it in a C function signature. And that's all very error prone. So how to interface? So that's basically the second half of my talk in the 21st century. And I've tried a couple of things. I will discuss them way at the end. But what I just want to show you today is this. It's just beautiful. Who has used this project before? Okay, good. So this is a wonderful project in terms of design and functionality. Yeah, so let's have a look. Just for reference, on GitHub, the project itself has 3,500 stars and 500 forks. So I would say they're doing quite well, right? It's not one of those 10-star projects like mine. So PyBind 11, what is it? So just an excerpt from the README of the project itself. Lightweight header-only library that exposes C++ types in Python, and importantly, also vice versa. In PyBind 11, you can be as insane as calling the Python interpreter from C++. Whoever wants to do that, but it's possible. So it's always a good sign if something like this is possible. So here's the supported interpreters. So it supports CPython 2.7, CPython 3, and also PyPy. PyPy? No? Yes? No? No. PyPy is an alternative way of interpreting Python code. And the aim of this project is speed, and it's really nice. And one of their major motivations was to get away with a lot of the shortcomings and restrictions in the way that the CPython interpreter is built. And the hint here is the great interpreter lock. And now I mentioned it, and I should not talk of it again. In any case, header only without dependencies, that's always very cool. Header only is very good because you don't need to actually compile any shared libraries and mingle with them in your package manager of your liking. And most importantly, without dependencies, because nothing is more worse as a header only library which doesn't convey to you its dependencies. And then you have to start searching and doing and which boost version fits here potentially, and yeah. Been there, done that, it was awful. But in any case, so here are the supported compilers. I think the list is quite good. So at least for me, I'm interested in cross-platform performance-relevant software. So these top three are always, if I see them, I'm like, cool. This is even better. So the Intel compiler, also in the HPC community where I'm typically going around, is considered the gold-plated standard in terms of performance and generating performant assembly on x86. So if you have all of those four, perfect. And it even has a very free license, I would say. So you can also use it in commercial products and whatnot. Yeah. So let's have a look, shall we? So let's go back to our MyMath. So first of all, you include the header. Well, duh, it's a header-only library. We define a function, again, add, based with int. Some aliasing just to be nice to ourselves. And then the only thing you have to do is to actually add to your code this macro here, PyBind 11 module, myMathM. Then you can add a documentation string to this object M here, which resembles the module object. And then you define a function. So far, so good. Quite minimal. If we compare this to what we had earlier, we already saved at least a factor of three of code. And I have to say, it gets even better. The nice thing is that I believe PyBind embraces like the everyday duties of C++ programmers because they come with a CMake example. It's lovely. You can just use it and then try to start integrating your workflow into this. Just go to this URL, and it actually comes with the setup. Maybe if we have time at the end, I can show you. And the only thing that you have to do is you have to add the directory where the PyBind 11 repository resides, and then you can just say PyBind 11 add module, whatever you want to call it, and then the path to your source code. So that's actually quite nice, and I think more of the explanation I leave for later. And when I saw this, like these two, I was like, it cannot get better, but it does. So then, of course, for those of you, and everybody said they know Python, so let's go a little bit deeper. So typically in C++, you could do something like this with some default arguments to the function signature, and PyBind is so nice, and actually bringing me to a position where I can actually port this to the Python side. So you see here, this is in the C++ side, and then I can even tell the Python interpreter, hey, my first argument is I, and it's supposed to have this default value, and the second argument is J. And if you know Python, when you call a function in Python, you can explicitly say, and it doesn't matter what kind of ordering you have in the arguments, I equals 42 and J 43, whatever. And this is even supported here. So this is quite nice. They even go do a one step further. If you deem this is necessary, they offer you some user-defined string literals, so you can suffix this character array with underscore A, which stands for argument, and then have a similar syntax. But that's a matter of taste, I would say. So let's go object-oriented. So here again, a person, similar to what we just had. Very simple constructor, set name method, get name method, and you can imagine whatever functionality you want down here. And how would you actually bring that to Python? Well, it turns out it's quite easy. So this incantation is the same that we just saw before. We again have to define this PyBind 11 module macro, give it some meaningful name, maybe example is not the best, and then define a variable. And then we can say, hey, person is a class, it has a name person, and then we have to initialize it. So this is basically a placeholder for the constructor, and then we can just go and add references to the actual implementations in our C++ API. And you can even go further. If you see this now from the Python side, so let's assume you have instantiated a person, then by default, the output looks like this. So this is the auto-generated string representation of an object. And you can even from your PyBind interface, so this is something that we've just seen so far, you can add these special, let's call them special functions for a Python class, and supply them with a lambda. And here in this case, this would be the lambda for the string representation of an instance. So this underscore, underscore, wrapper, underscore, underscore. And here we would actually change the output of this call there. And as you can see, it actually does what is expected. So you can actually start moving more closer to, let's say, what a Python developer would expect. Okay. Inheritance. Now let's really do a little bit of object orientation here in a very simplified form. So we have a base class, which is person. We've seen that already. And then we derive from this, we define a coder. And the only thing that he has to do is do some work. And then he typically is sometimes very frustrated. And that's why he just says do. And how would you do that in Python? So here again, we've seen that so far. Here we can actually start talking about the permission, so read-write permissions for a member variable that we've seen so far. There are different other definitions of def, so most notably def read-only in comparison to read-write. So here this just tells the Python interpreter, okay, in this case, the Python interpreter can write into name at any point, and apparently, or of course, read-only, well, it's read-only. And if you want to add our derived class coder, Then we just go ahead, add coder to the template parameter of PyClass, but then what we actually have to do, we actually have to supply the parent as well. From then on, it's actually the same thing as we just seen before. Again, the constructor and the actual member functions. And here is the example of how that would look. So again, we define an instance of coder. We can actually query the name. So here we actually didn't change it. And if we call work, then we get our string back. Okay. So, all right, so Python objects, that's actually quite nice. So you can also do go back and forth. So from the C++ side, you can actually receive Python objects. For those of you who work with Python, you know dictionaries, you know lists, you know sets, you know those things that you don't need to import anything for. And here I just picked an example, how would you print a Python dictionary from the C++ side. Actually quite straightforward, I would say. But you can actually already see a couple of details, important details of PyBind. So while PyBind itself actually gives you the option of representing the dictionary object just as a type. So most of you know, I hope, that the types inside a dictionary can vary. So we don't need to have homogeneous types. So here we don't see that, because naturally in a C++ container way, you would say container and then template parameter, whatever type is contained as a key, for example, and something that is contained as a value. And that's actually not the case. Rather, what PyBind does is that if you loop over all these entries, it offers you a couple of casting methods. So here we want to cast this item to a string, and then we have to construct a standard string from this. And here you actually see the transition from Python to the C++ world, okay? Because at some point you simply have to do that. And the rest is plain C++. You, as we did before, you add this print dictionary function to the module itself, and from Python it would look like this. So first you import the function from this MyMath module, and then you just call it with an arbitrary dictionary. And here you actually see what I meant earlier, that you have heterogeneous types, right? So this is a string, this is an integer, this is a string, this is again a string. Okay, so that's what I meant. Yeah, that these casting methods here, they are very, very much required. Yeah, and then this is what the output, what you actually get. Yep. So, yeah, you don't see this, unfortunately, I have to apologize, but what I can only recommend you is, I mean, when you start exploring this universe of PyBind 11, you cannot stop. That's just what happens to me when I read the documentation, which is barely readable down here, because it just offers functionality over functionality over functionality. It's really nice, and this is what I try to convey with this image. So, what didn't I discuss? There are a couple of competitors to actually do the same thing. So first of all, Boost Python. PyBind, the authors itself themselves claim that they use the good and bad experiences from Boost Python and try to come up with something better. I started having a look into Boost Python. Currently, I have the feeling it's a hot debate in terms of Boost, because the Boost project is very viral when you use it in your own project, even though the many package managers started to actually offer you Boost in a modular fashion. But many developers, that at least from discussions I had, consider Boost to be a very viral project, meaning that once it's in your project, you never get rid of it. Okay, so that's why many people in legacy code probably still use Boost Python, but I have the feeling PyBind 11 is the more favorable project. The next thing that I wanted to highlight is that the development in Boost Python is a little bit come to a grinding, not almost a halt. If you check the documentation, the timestamp is 2015 or so, which is not good for documentation of the latest Boost release. So, which is this year. So that's 3 years in between. But can that the reason for this can be arbitrary, of course. So I'm not sure about Boost Python. It looks very likely like PyBind 11, but yeah, I don't know. I'm more happy with this flexible nature of PyBind 11. Then something that many of you potentially know is the Swig project. So the Swig project allows you to interface any language to any language. I think that's what it characterizes. My experiences with Swig are very mixed. I have the impression that depending on what you're interested in, if your product is basically restricted to a single OS, then maybe you are fine with Swig. But as soon as you go into portable projects so that you actually have to support Windows, Linux, and whatnot, Swig can be a little bit tricky. So Swig itself, what you have to do, you have to write an intermediate representation of your API, and then the Swig application actually generates the binding for you. So we can debate later on if that's better than PyBind. It's a super interesting project, but I started to leave my fingers from it, at least for the task at hand, if I'm only interested in Python. Then the next... lights. Lights. And then, almost illegible. In any case, and the other approach is to actually mix C code or C-like code into Python would be these two. These are two Python modules. One is called C-types, where you actually start to do static typing in Python, and thereby helping the interpreter to actually not use Py objects, but rather use an int for an int, another Py object for an int. Okay, and then the other project is CFFI, and that's really crazy because there we go into the OpenGL land kind of thing. You have to supply your C programs as strings to the Python interpreters. Yay, that's horrible. I don't want to do that because only at runtime you actually see if you coded something wrong, right? So that's always very tricky. Languages in languages, not such a good idea. In any case, So this brings me to my almost last slide. So what I like about PyBind 11 is it's an open source project that offers you Python bindings from C++ and vice versa. It has a very active community, I have to say, and the documentation is just extensive. From my point of view, it's very mature. I've already used it in one or two projects. So that was actually the experience was very smooth, and I have the feeling it covers, at least for me, 80 to 90% of the use cases I can actually think of. And that's why I didn't put 100, because probably I'm missing out on something. In any case, so check out this GitHub URL, PyBind and PyBind 11. I think for those of you that use Conan, I think it's already in Conan IO, right? About VC package, I don't know. Do you guys know what VC package in Conan is? I'm assuming here. VC package, who's using VC package? VC package is the package manager by Microsoft. Okay, that's what reads the GitHub repo. It's the package manager for Windows, Linux, and Mac. I can only cite that here. Actually, I have to say to its defense, so apparently Microsoft learned from the NuGet disaster that hardly anybody is using NuGet, so the package manager inside of Visual Studio. And they came up with this project. It's very CMake-based, so it's quite nice. And Conan IO, I think. Conan also package manager. Now I spent 30 minutes. I would actually show you real quick how the code looks like from the CMake example project. And then I'm pretty much done. Would that be okay? Who's in favor of continuing in a hot room with 30 people? Uh-oh, you are daring. Okay, so let's see how we can do that. And I will expose you to my very elaborate development environment, which is called the terminal. And it's super small. So, but we can make it bigger. Okay, exactly. So basically, this is super, super small. So the CMake, I'm sweating like mad. So the CMake test package looks very humble. So here inside the source directory, you actually have the C++ code that you want to hand over to Python. You have a CMake lists file that you can safely ignore if you want, because it just contains the lines that I just had in my slides. And the important part to start with is this setup.py. So let's have a look at this. So as you all said that you are very experienced Python programmers, you already have written multiple of these setup.pys, right? Not really, huh? Yeah, that's what I thought. I only, since, I don't know, I'm using Python since 8 years, I've only written one. So it's fine. So the nice thing is that it actually comes with CMake support. So what this does is inside the setup tools, so the Python package that actually administers these setup.py files, it's calling CMake for you. And it's quite nice because then you can actually encapsulate away the CMake part and then just basically tell it, here's the CMake.lists file, and you just go. And that's about it. You first have to, this is mostly boilerplate. Here's the actual path to the C++ source code. And then it does some very crafty and elaborate checks. It calls CMake minus minus version and passes the output. So that's as crude as it can get. But in any case, it reads from that the CMake version, and then it goes on and on and on. And that's all. And then you can supply flags if you want, and it's very modular. But the important part is actually way down here. You can ignore this, most of this. Is actually just this function, because that's what distutils is for. So that the developer can just write these big functions with, I think by default it has 30 or so arguments, this single function, because it's one of those historic developments, I'm guessing. And here you actually define your module. And from here you actually interface your CMake project as we had up there, and that's about it. So it's really just a couple of additions, edits here and there, and then you are already ready to go. And nota bene, this is cross-platform, right? If you don't have some fancy setup on Windows XP with Visual Studio 2017 or something like this, okay? So I'm talking about like mainstream setups, okay? And that's about it. And then just to show you that I'm, so then if we go into the source, in the source, there's just this one file, which we will recall in a minute. So here's our add function, haha, and then here's our PyBind 11 module. You define some doc string, so a documentation string that have a specific format. This one is, I think, compliant to read the docs, and then here's our actual implementation, just as we've seen in the slides. And we can add some documentation, and then we can even add more functions, etc., etc. So now we're gonna go into danger land, because I'm gonna call compile this stuff. So everything that I need to do is call Python 3. I hope you can see this. Let's go up. So from here, let's just call Python 3, setup.py, and then build. So for those of you who use CMake, you will immediately recognize that something is going on, namely that the actual interface is built. So what the project spits out is a shared library. I'm on Linux, so this is a .so file, and in Windows it's a DLL. Yeah, I guess you know the game. And then it's built. Now the thing is, when I now call, let me get rid of, if I now call Python, and want to import my, what do I call it, CMake example. Then of course nothing happens, because the shared library is not known to the interpreter, because it's in a non-standard position or location, okay? So I could call Python setup py install, which I'm not gonna do now. I'm gonna do the good old Linux trick, namely I'm changing my environment. Whoa. Okay, and I already did that just before coming, so I can do something like this. So this is now I'm changing an environment variable, which is called Python path, and the Python interpreter, whenever it starts up, it will pass this and check in all the directories inside this path if they contain any modules. And now I did that, and now we can do that again, and it goes through. No errors means the module was loaded. Okay, so that's a very nice, simple trick. Just load the module, then from there you can actually see, okay, something is actually doable. So then let's fire up our REPL, and then we can say example, and then we can say CMake add 42 and 43. And there you get 85. Okay? Yes?
I think instead of modifying Python path, you could do Python setup build x minus minus in place.
Yes, I think. Yeah, that's true.
I'm not sure if it's possible in this CMake example because it kind of depends a little bit on your other setups.
Yes, yeah, I know. So I chose this way because it's much more secure. Here for the demonstration, at least. Yeah. So yeah, so this was, by the way, my talk. Any questions? Yes?
What if I have a template class which I want to export to this Python?
Yeah. Then you have to wind down the road that you actually have to give PyBind the possible types. So you have to supply the instantiations. Yes? Yes. Or you do the casting madness. That's also possible if you want to do that. So it's up. I think that's what I understood so far. Yeah.
So what happens with tag mismatches?
So say what again?
With tag mismatches. So if we now call CMake example as 42 square.
Like this? So in this case, it will actually throw me an error, because I actually, the way, if you remember in the, I could actually just show you. Why am I talking? So here we defined the function with ints, and the problem is, here we only supply a pointer or a reference, a pointer to the function itself. And this is bound to the types. So here there's no way out. It boils a little bit, it goes back to this question that we just had about the template types. As far as I understood, what you can do, either you just supply, okay, I want to support ints and floats and in all combinations thereof. That's something you can do, so you would have to have like a loop of through all the types. And I think the other thing was, now I'm struggling a little bit, because in my use case this wasn't the case. I think, Axel?
There are two ways what I expose. They have like a Py object that you can use as an
yes.
object. Yes. This accepts just all the types and then you have to cast inside the function.
Yes.
And for the NumPy functions, they also have a thing which is instead of having like a int or like vector and then template, they just have a Py array type. And there you can also put anything in there and then you have to
yes.
say, now I want to have this as floats or doubles and otherwise I will do something else.
Thank you. So it ties back to the dictionary example that we had. You remember where you just say PyDict, and then you inside the function you can cast around however you want. But I think I tried the other thing with fixing the types, because there in my use case it was a little bit better, because then I could actually say no, I only want to support doubles. Period. You know, that was at least my use case. That's why. Now I'm there again. Okay. Thank you.
Say something about memory management.
Yes. Yeah, sure. So that's actually quite it's lovely about the library. So where did my browser go? There it is. So I prepared some additional slides. No, don't be scared. Yeah. So I think it's down here and it's barely visible. No, that's not so nice. So this is, by the way, the example where you can hold the gil. So that's quite nice. If you have multi-threaded code, hey, we can actually tell the interpreter, stop now. I'm going to use all the threads and then you can continue. That's very cool. Although there's a big debate in the Python world if we should actually go that far. Totally different story. Yeah, how do I? I'm a little bit worried that you cannot see anything. You know what? Let's improvise. That's always the best. So presentations. Let's improvise. Big time. I will show you the code. So I hope you can see that a little bit. So let's assume we have something like this. We have a function that basically throws around pointers to some static memory. Okay, so let's assume we are inside an object and we have some static state and it's something greater than a byte, something that we actually allocated with new. And the intriguing fact thing is that we actually return a pointer to it. Dangerous, because we allocated memory on the C side. And as I told you in the beginning, Python is managed memory, reference counting, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. Now, the thing is, if you actually just supply this to a Python, this will happen. Kaboom. The thing will explode. The interpreter will just stop and just say, no, I don't know what memory region you're talking about. I cannot interpret this in any way. Right? Because what we didn't do, we didn't wrap it. At the end of the day, PyBind just wraps it into this strange C API that we started with. So we have to do something about it. And the project actually helps us. So I'm sorry that my slides got wrapped. So you can actually define a couple of policies. So here, what you actually define, so here's again the syntax. You define a function. In our case, it's getData. You supply the reference to the function itself. And then you define a return value policy. Here in this case, you say to the interpreter, please use this memory region by reference. Okay. And the library itself, under this link, I will fix the slides later on. On this link, you can actually find 7 or 8 policies that you can actually define. So how memory is actually swapped between your C runtime or C++ runtime in our case and the Python runtime. So if you just want to do a move, if you want to do a copy, if you just want to hand it over by reference. So all this kind of nitty-gritty details that you want to actually take care about. Yeah? If you're really, for example, memory bound and you want to stay low in the memory consumption. So this is actually what a very nice feature of the library that you can have control as deep as this.
So can I create an object in C++ using new or something, give it to the Python side, and Python will get rid of it for me when it doesn't need it anymore? Or does it give me some kind of callback that I have to...
So that treads into very tricky waters, because there are multiple ways of doing that. PyBind itself offers a share pointer, basically, that you can, that actually is, I think, for this scenario, where you allocate something and then give it over to Python and say, do what you want with it. Okay, and then it's up to the Python interpreter to actually delete it. Yeah? Here in this case, it assumes that you still, this assumes that you still keep control, still ownership of the memory, but you don't have to. As I said, you can also say, do whatever you want. Okay. Say what again?
Python.
Yes. No. I looked at it once. It was too C for me, as the name suggests. Like 5. Yeah, I admit it was 5 years ago. And then I didn't have a look at the code again. The thing is, with Siphon, and you can correct me, that's probably wrong what I'm going to say. But the good thing here is that everything stays well separated for me. So that's quite nice because I have my build system, my C++ build system, I have my Python build system, I can use Python unit testing, whatever I want. And it's really well separated. My last impression for Siphon was that it starts to do this, which is never something I like. But I can be wrong. Am I wrong?
Start with Python,
To static typing.
And yes.
Variables like types.
Yes.
And then you can generate C code.
Yes. Okay.
This, from my point of view, is also separate.
Okay. Okay. Okay.
Yeah, but it's the other way around.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Thank you.
I have to say I used both PyBind 11 and Cython. So I didn't like Cython because it's like kind of a in between language that doesn't have any tool support at all, or almost no. So if you want to, you know, write C++ 11, you can do it with this, with PyBind 11, but you can't do it with Cython directly. You have to do an in between Cython file, and then you have to do C++ files. And if you want to, you know, Cython generates this really ugly C code, which is 1,000 lines long for 10 lines of Cython code. And if you throw a GDB into this shared library and do it, you don't want to debug. Because the variable names are something like underscore x125. I didn't like this. So, but I know that's quite used in sync. They use it, but they use it for actually not for binding, but for a little bit for binding also, but also for writing just fast code.
So interesting. Okay.
Something more
yes.
on these lines, maybe
go ahead.
Ridiculous. I also come from more from the Python side.
So yes.
We want to have Python, and then we have some problem. We want to outsource someone.
Yes.
C++. And I grew up with even Weave, which is even older and
ooh.
Not done anymore.
Yeah.
Can you just give a few words? Like, I never understood what the problem with Weave was because I'm like low
me
level.
Neither. Me neither. Yeah.
Okay, so you also don't know why
no.
they don't continue on that because.
My context of Weave is Stack Overflow. This doesn't work. This, how does this work? This kind of level, so no, sorry. Axel.
Maybe I can just comment on the different ones because I think the question is really from where you come from. If you have a large Python code base and you just have one bottleneck, then there are a lot of modern ways like number, for example, number four or Python actually is also one thing. They, at the end, they are all LLVM based and try to compile your Python code into actual x86 code. But PyBind is actually the way where you really start from. You have a large C++ code base and want to open to the Python code. And yeah, for the other ones where we just have very small bottlenecks and you don't want to go to large libraries like BLAS or FFT libraries, then you're probably easy with number and stuff like this. But yeah, for the code base of C++.
Yeah. Cool.
Do you know anything about performance differences between all those different approaches? Because sort of from my experience not with Python but with other languages, getting them to work with C++, half the time is spent in copying the data between the different roles and making sure the types are right and all that. Is there differences, for instance, between what PyBind does and what Boost Python does or so?
So the authors of PyBind say yes, they're better. It's always a great statement. they actually have a benchmark package that you can actually try. It's one of the repositories in the PyBind team account. They actually claim, because what we just discussed with these memory policies, they actually claim that this neat little trick in conjunction with the shared pointers that they offer, or the shared pointer support, I would say, they are actually better, and that they keep the overhead of copying or not copying very, very low, if not zero. And I haven't made measurements myself. It's an intriguing idea, by the way. But so something one could do, but I believe them, to be honest. Because I think if an API offers me this, that's like a universe better than what I know from Java, like where it's everything is so encapsulated so well, but you don't have any control over it anymore. You know. So I think, I personally, I don't know about the others, we had two PyBind 11 users. So do you know anything about memory footprint and duplication of data? Axel? Yeah, but that's I'm talking about the size. Did you see anything?
I tried some stuff with getting NumPy arrays that are really big that I don't want to copy into PyBind 11, and you have to read a very long documentation page on this to understand what's going on. But you have all the options like this. Basically, you can even do something like you have. Say you have a method that in C++ that operates on some memory region, like just an array, that's float array, let's say. And you now want to plug into this float array and into this method a NumPy array. So that was my use case, at least. You can actually expose the NumPy pointer into this method as long as your memory layout is actually compatible. So that's possible then. In this case, you have no overhead in terms of memory copying. So it's just a method call or a function call overhead that I don't know about because I don't care. Because you know, this method takes like 10 seconds, so I don't care about some nanoseconds that the call to the PyBind design takes. But yeah, it's, I guess you have all the options.
They even allow you in the time of the argument to restrict yourself to only matching one. So if you really want to make sure that the layout matches, you have all the template parameters for that.
That's pretty nice. So the NumPy interface is super cool. You have to live with a little bit of casting, but but it works wonders. Because my clients also use NumPy for representing images. So that's where I started to use that project. Wow. Okay. Good. Yeah, I think you can also we can also discuss later, but let's close the session, I would say.
Thank you.
You're welcome.